Marriage, hey, it happens all of the time. And as a lot of us are aware today, prior to a marriage, many people enter into an agreement that will determine what happens to their property in the event they later get a divorce or one of the parties dies. It's known generally as a prenuptial agreement, an agreement that takes place before the marriage. Okay, well, how are these things actually applied? Takes us to this week's case. It involves a couple in Nebraska. And there they had been living together for about 3 years before they planned to get married. They were living in his house. And he was a guy that had a net worth that was considered to be somewhere between $1 to $2 million. All right, making plans for the wedding, they had talked about a prenuptial agreement and setting up an agreement that would divide the property in the event of a divorce, but they decided not to go forward with that. And they're getting closer and closer to the marriage, and unbeknownst to her, he goes out and has a prenuptial agreement drawn up. Five days before the marriage, he says, "Here you go, sweetheart. Here's a prenuptial agreement. Sign it." She says, "Well, I don't know about this." He says, "Sign it or the marriage is off." Well, what's a girl to do? I don't know. Anyway, she then proceeded to sign the prenuptial agreement. Well, they got married. And we fast forward. And as we fast forward, we find out the relationship didn't go quite as both of them had wanted it to go. So they filed for divorce. When they filed for divorce, he jumped up and said, "Here's a prenuptial agreement. This sets forth the way in which the property will be divided." She said, through her lawyers, "No, prenuptial agreement doesn't apply. It doesn't apply for a number of reasons. One, I basically was coerced. I was told, take it or leave it. Two, is that, you know, I never had a full disclosure of what his property was. I didn't know what I was giving up. And three, in that five-day period, practically, I did not have an opportunity to get a lawyer." He argued, "Well, wait a second. We could have always delayed the marriage. We could have gotten married later. She would have had an opportunity to consult with a lawyer. A number of things could have been done." To which she responded, "Of course, you got to be nuts. We've already paid for the caterers. We've already had this whole thing going on. People are coming in from out of town. Our relatives are here. Lots of expenses have been incurred. If we're going to get married, this was the time and place to get married. But basically, with that looming over me, I didn't have much choice but to sign that prenuptial agreement." Okay. Well, this went up all the way to the Nebraska Supreme Court. And there the Nebraska Supreme Court heard both her arguments and his arguments. And they looked at the fact that, yes, arguably this was coerced since it took place immediately prior to the marriage for all intents and purposes. Okay. But more importantly, in that period of time, she practically did not have an opportunity to see another lawyer to have her review the actual prenuptial agreement. And the other thing is that, importantly, there was no full disclosure. She didn't know what was going on. She didn't know what he was worth. She didn't know what his earnings capability was going to be. Didn't know any of this stuff. And therefore, she was uninformed. And you can't enter a negotiation in good faith if you're uninformed. In view of all of this, the Nebraska Supreme Court said basically, "Sweetheart, you're right. You do not have an enforceable prenuptial agreement, and we go back to ground zero. There is no prenuptial agreement, and the property will be divided pursuant to the marital property laws in the state of Nebraska." All right. What did we learn from this? We learned that even though there may be a prenuptial agreement, it may not be enforceable. We learned that the party who signs the agreement has to have full disclosure from the other party. This works both ways. Has to have a right to consult with an attorney and has to have a right to reflectively consider whether or not this is something they want to do. All right, we bring you this case as we bring you cases every week so you know how the law works. I'm David Allen.